There is another way in which you can live that does not create further suffering for yourself. Because to a large extent, humans create their own suffering. And so, when you are ready to hear that message, and that's really the message that is in every religion, that's the message, the central message of Buddhism is the end of suffering. And even the central message of the teaching of Jesus is finding the pearl of great price, finding the kingdom of heaven that is within you here and now, as Jesus says. And that, of course, is the end of living in a state of suffering.
Hello, Bezel T3. That was Eckhart Tolle, favorite New Age guru of Oprah Winfrey, talking about how to end suffering by misinterpreting the words of Jesus regarding the kingdom of God. Jesus did not teach the kingdom of God is within everybody. He was saying that by him, in the first century, being on the scene, the kingdom of God is now in the midst of the people he was speaking to. It is Jesus himself that is the pearl of great price. You know, I need to do a video on that misinterpretation of the phrase, the kingdom of heaven is within you, but that's for another time. I just did a video on the differences between Buddhism and Christianity as it pertains to suffering. So if interested, you can check that out on my channel. Here, though, I want to talk about the reality of suffering and the proper response to it as a Christian. See, the question is, why do we suffer? Why do bad things happen to decent people, and why do immoral people seem to prosper? Why did the hurricane devastate that city? Is God punishing me because I sinned? These kinds of questions confront us every single day. Suffering is a reality in this life, and yet, when it hits us personally, most of us begin by thinking or asking the question, why me? When tragedy occurs in others, we of course want to comfort those who are suffering, but we're not sure how to do it. What can we say that won't make them feel worse? You know, the Bible has long been a source of comfort, but what exactly does it teach about suffering? What can it do to help us understand how to cope with tragedy while the suffering are comforted by us? You know, the Bible talks a lot about suffering. There's a whole book devoted to the topic. The book of Job is an extended reflection on suffering, why it happens, what we can know about it, and where we should draw our comfort from. The New Testament is full of teachings on suffering, on tragedies, and death. All these teachings ultimately should point us to Christ, our Savior, the only true source of comfort. And developing a solid theology of suffering will enable us, when suffering does come our way, to say with Job, "For I know that my Redeemer lives." You know, there are certain quarters of American Christianity that focused almost entirely on the quality of the Christian life in the present moment. One well-known pastor wrote this in one of his many books on what I want to call Christian self-improvement. He writes, "God has already done everything he's going to do. The ball is now in your court. If you want success, if you want wisdom, if you want prosperity and health, you're gonna have to do more than meditate and believe. You must boldly declare words of faith and victory over yourself and your family." Now, contrast those words with the words found in these passages from the book of Psalms. Psalm 10. "Why, Lord, do you stand far off? Why do you hide in times of trouble?" Or Psalm 88. "But I, O Lord, cry to you. In the morning my prayer comes before you. O Lord, why do you cast my soul away? Why do you hide your face from me? Afflicted and close to death from my youth up, I suffer your terrors. I am helpless. Your wrath has swept over me. Your dreadful assaults destroy me. They surround me like a flood all day long. They close in on me together. You have caused my beloved and my friend to shun me. Darkness has become my only companion. Well, the question is, what happens when you've declared words of faith and victory over yourself and your family, and yet really bad stuff happens to you or your loved ones or others that you know? The fact of the matter is this: if you live long enough, you're going to suffer. It could be the sudden death or the protracted death of a loved one, perhaps a chronic illness. Perhaps it's a national disaster, an earthquake, a flood, or tornado. These things can happen at any time, and suffering will result, and it is very real. And most of us, like I said before, if we're honest, would say that our first thought when confronted with sudden tragedy is, why me? You know, we echo the words of the psalmist in Psalm 42, Lord, why have you forgotten me? It's so true. If you haven't suffered yet, you're going to. It's just a matter of time. It's part of the human experience. And the thing about suffering is, if handled from the right perspective, it makes us sensitive to those who are suffering difficult hardships. Those who understand suffering are much better equipped to comfort those who are presently suffering. Job, after losing all his possessions and then his health, responds by saying these kinds of things: the Lord gave and the Lord has taken away. And shall we receive good things from God and not evil? All the while continuing to worship God. However, if you've been fed nothing but victory, overcoming, and having your best life now, if that's your Christian diet, well then when suffering comes your way, you will be completely unprepared and washed over by the waves of suffering. Suffering has lasting effects on us. It changes the way we relate to God and His promises as found in His Word. We need to have the right perspective here, folks. Remember, in Philippians, Paul wrote to this church in Philippi while he was in prison. Chapter 4, he says, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And here's the promise: and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. But how are we to apply this promise of God's peace guarding our hearts and minds while in the midst of being tossed about by the winds and waves of suffering? Well, here's what we need to have. We need to have a larger understanding of exactly who we are being called to as Christians. Let's go back to what Paul had written about himself a little earlier in this letter to the Philippians. He says, finally, my brothers, rejoice in the Lord. He says it again. To write these same things to you is no trouble for me, and it's safe or helpful for you. Rejoicing in the Lord in the midst of difficult circumstances is what Paul is wanting them to get, and he keeps saying it. So there must be good reason to do so. He writes this. He says, look out for the dogs. Look out for the evildoers. Look out for those who mutilate the flesh. Now, these are the false teachers who were teaching human effort in opposition to faith in Christ alone. Paul goes so far as to call them evildoers. He says about the people in Philippi, the true believers, he says, we are the circumcision who worship by the Spirit of God and glory in Jesus Christ and put no confidence in the flesh, or the works of the flesh, circumcision, or whatever it might be that someone's saying you have to do to be okay with God. Paul is saying that the true Christian is the one who has been circumcised with a circumcision made without hands. These who were once dead in sin and now made alive in Christ by the regenerating power of the Spirit, having been forgiven of all their sins by the person and work of Christ. Paul then goes on to describe what he once was before he realized this great truth. He says this, he says, though I myself have reason for confidence in the flesh also, if anyone else he thinks he has reason for confidence in the flesh, I have more. circumcised on the eighth day, of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews, and as to the law, a Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law, blameless. Now, that's quite a resume if works righteousness and the old covenant were able to save you. But Paul does go on to tell what all that was worth. He says this, he says, "But whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ. Indeed, I count everything loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things and count them as dung, in order that I might gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends entirely on faith." Do you get that? Not declaring words of faith and victory over himself, but rather that which comes through faith in Christ outside of himself. He goes on, he says, "that I might know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead." Wow, your life now will only last so long, and then you're going to die, if the Lord tarries. But there it is, the end game that transcends any kind of suffering, the resurrection from the dead. That is what we will get as Christians through our sufferings. You see, we must as Christians be thinking this way, because we are all at risk. You know, we're not going to admit this, but we're all at risk of living our lives expecting God to reward us for good behavior. You know, do this and then God will give you good things. Be obedient and God will bless you. But that's not the way it works, folks. And when suffering hits us, we can easily turn on God and his promises. But Paul turns this kind of thinking on its head. The thing about suffering is that it will reveal what we really believe about God and his promises. It is during times of trial that we find out what we are actually clinging to for hope. And that is why a sound theology, a fully orbed theology of God, of man, of sin, and redemption is so important and so practical. It will protect us from the danger of misapplying biblical promises to our situation. I'll give you an example. Take Isaiah 53:5 for example, okay? "But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him, and by his wounds," or his stripes, "we are healed." Now, this has been misapplied over and over again. But what it's really saying, it does not mean that because Christ was wounded that we will be healed here and now from all diseases in this life. What it does mean is that one day we will be healed, in that there will be no more pain or disease or suffering in the life to come. Remember, back to, "if I may attain the resurrection from the dead and be glorified like our Lord Jesus was glorified and now sits at God's right hand." Fully human, but glorified, right? God-man, fully human. You know, I want to say truly human, truly divine, at the right hand of God. That is the promise for us. Now, people are suffering all around us in big and little ways. And we as Christians should be willing, want to be willing, and should be prepared to help and comfort them. And the church, which, by the way, is the kingdom of God on earth, that's where it's to be found right now, is the best place for people to learn about God, the gospel, sin, and suffering. And it's also the place where fellow Christians can encourage and build up one another, even in the midst of suffering. Sometimes, however, our best intentions can have unintended consequences. You see, in the midst of our own suffering, or when trying to comfort someone who is suffering, how soon, if at all, should we want to go to passages such as Romans 8:28? For we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. That, most likely, should not be the first thing out of our mouths. Rather, we can do the one thing that Job's friends, who turned out to be his tormentors, actually, the one thing they did right when they first came upon him and saw him sitting there, shell-shocked from the onslaught of the sudden calamity that came upon him. We read there, "Now when Job's three friends heard of all the evil that had come upon him, they came each from his own place. And when they saw him from a distance, they did not recognize him. And they raised their voices and wept, and they tore their robes and sprinkled dust on their heads toward heaven. And they sat with him on the ground 7 days and seven nights, and no one spoke a word to him. For they saw that his suffering was very great." See, it wasn't until they opened their mouths that they began putting their foot into it. Sometimes the best thing that we can do to comfort someone who is suffering is just be there with them. There will be time, if the Lord wills, to talk to them when they're ready to talk. But don't avoid the reality of someone's pain. Acknowledge it and be there for them. Romans 12:15, "Rejoice with those who are rejoicing and weep with those who are weeping."